The Carroll series of siege mortars were very, very effective under the right circumstances. They were designed for siege warfare, and they were designed to be brought up very close to the defences, where they could fire these enormous heavyweight shells, which were so destructive they could take out concrete bunkers and very well emplaced concrete defences. The problem with a weapon like that is you must have complete air superiority, you must have the ability to move it up to the defences and know that it's not going to be vulnerable to counter-attack. In a siege like Sevastopol, all of those circumstances prevailed.
Although the Carl series' top speed on roads or firm terrain was claimed to be 10 kilometres an hour, they were simply too large and cumbersome to be considered as self-propellant. The largest of all the artillery pieces was equally cumbersome. The 80-centimetre railgun Schwer Gustav, 80-centimetre KE, known as Dora, was sighted 16 kilometres away from Sevastopol on specially laid tracks. It took 2 weeks to emplace, so it wasn't until the third day of the barrage that its 1,300-man crew fired their first round. By the time they had finished, 48 shells had been fired at a variety of targets, all of which were completely demolished. Perhaps the most spectacular success was the destruction of an underground ammunition magazine 30 meters under Sevanaya Bay. 8 shots were fired at this target, which was completely destroyed, and a small sailing ship was sunk in the process.
This is an 800-millimeter projectile. It went to a gun called Schwer Gustav. The problem with that gun is that it took 5,000 men to erect the gun. It took 6 weeks to do it. It had a firing crew of 500. It had a major general for a gun captain. So in my own little way, I like to think that that gun helped the Allies win World War II.
By employing massive amounts of super-heavy siege artillery in a concentrated area, the forces of the Wehrmacht were literally able to dismantle the city of Sevastopol, block by block. The slow-moving siege artillery was extremely vulnerable to attack from the air, so it was imperative that the Germans controlled the skies. With this control, the Wehrmacht was able to take its time and set up the siege guns with careful consideration to their targeting. Without harassment from the defenders, the siege guns and conventional artillery emplaced around Sevastopol were able to fire over 1,000 tons of ordnance onto the town. After Sevastopol, as the Allies took back control of the skies, and supplies became scarce, these weapons became more of a hindrance than a help. Of the various German schemes for superweapons, none seems as wasteful as the superguns, being costly in raw materials, manpower, and supplies. As static pieces of siege equipment, there was no questioning the effect of mortars and railguns, but even the 80-centimeter KE creators, Krupp, admitted, while it was a valuable research tool, as a practical weapon of war, it was useless with the advent of the aeroplane. Blitzkrieg rendered the super-heavy guns obsolete. In sharp contrast to Sevastopol was the 900-day siege of Leningrad. The mighty Wehrmacht artillery was able to crush the fortress port of Sevastopol, but Leningrad held out for nearly 3 years. Perhaps the main reason was that Sevastopol was given priority over Leningrad in order to prevent the German army's southern flank from being exposed as Army Group South made its push to the oil-rich Caucasus. The Wehrmacht siege train of super-heavy artillery was directed south against Sevastopol and Leningrad, and was therefore spared from the heaviest of the guns. South of the city of Leningrad, Observatory Hill near the city of Pushkin was captured in September 1941, and the tower situated at the top provided German artillery spotters with an unimpeded view of the entire city of Leningrad. The city was placed within range of the Wehrmacht's artillery batteries, and by November, a continuous artillery barrage had begun. In just 2 months, between September and November 1941, a total of 272 German artillery bombardments slammed into the city over a total of 430 hours. Conventional German artillery lacked the concrete-smashing ability of the super-heavies being brought to bear on Sevastopol, and many of the well-constructed buildings of Leningrad stood up to the blasts. Although Hitler's forces could probably have taken Leningrad by storm in 1941, Hitler was reluctant to give the order. While the relentless German artillery took many lives in Leningrad, starvation was, in fact, the biggest killer. Leningrad was shaken to its very foundations, and resistance nearly collapsed. But in the end, the German guns were simply not large enough to crush the city into submission.
No single weapon can win a battle. You can fire a lot of artillery rounds at a town, at a city, in the case of Leningrad. You can kill a lot of people, maim thousands, make everybody miserable. But without actually facing the formidable defenses of the city, without attacking it with infantry, taking the losses and the risks that's attached to that, you can't expect the city to just put its hands up and surrender. Really, the German army in Russia had the ability to either reduce Leningrad or reduce Sevastopol. They didn't have the resources to do both in 1942, with the result that the decision was to concentrate on the operations of Army Group South.
Fresh from the success at Sevastopol in August of 1942, General von Manstein, along with five divisions and the Sevastopol siege train, were ordered north to Leningrad. But the offensive was cancelled at the end of September. Hitler was now concerned about the approaching Russian winter, and the siege guns were never adequately massed and brought to bear against Leningrad. By October, Soviet reinforcements were able to enter in the battle sufficient numbers and begin the task of pushing the German artillery back. It would take until January 1944, but eventually, Leningrad would be saved.